Would you please take your seats? We're about to start our keynote address. Thank you. I'm Herb Silverman, and in the interest of time, I'll not talk about Dr. Jerry Coyne's outstanding resume, which is in your program, but his books will be available for sale after the talk. Now, I would like to apologize to Dr. Coyne for what happened a couple of years ago at my institution, the College of Charleston, when he was invited for a Darwin Day talk on the topic, Are Science and Faith Compatible? Dr. Rob Dillon, who organized the event, is an evolutionary biologist and also a committed Christian. After the debate, Dr. Dillon became very upset with Dr. Coyne. As far as I can tell, Dillon was angry because Dr. Coyne presented his case so well and criticized religion so effectively in the debate. Dr. Dillon became upset in part because he feared that some in the audience might abandon evolution while others might abandon Christianity. For Dr. Dillon, both outcomes are bad. And for Dr. Coyne, one of those outcomes is good. Whatever Dr. Dillon's view, his inappropriate outburst was in no way appropriate for how to treat a guest. And I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Jerry Coyne for his keynote address on Why Science Leads to Atheism and Humanism, which I'm sure this audience will appreciate more than Dr. Dillon would. Thank you.
Thanks, Herb, for reviving that unpleasant memory. I guess being a humanist, I should forgive Dr. Dillon. But I can't bring myself to. So, thanks for coming out on Sunday, which is Ceiling Cats Day. And in honor of that, I will give you a Sunday secular sermon. I'd also like to thank the AHA and also Maggie, who's done a terrific job with this meeting, for inviting me. It's been a real pleasure listening to all the diverse speakers. Today, well, the topic of my talk is right there, and I'm going to say what Jared Diamond said should not be said, which is that science has an ineluctable connection with atheism. In fact, my thesis is in the title, Why Evolutionary Biology Promotes Atheism and Humanism. Now, we already know that atheism promotes humanism, okay? How many of you would characterize yourself as atheists or agnostics? Raise your hand. Okay, that's almost unanimous. And I think that for most of you, the rejection of God as a means of solace, of taking care of yourself, was the first step, perhaps, on the road to adopting a humanistic philosophy where we have to rely on ourselves and each other to make it through on spaceship Earth. What I'm going to add to the promotion of atheism by evolutionary biology, and I'll try to make my case with numbers, hopefully not too boring, is that evolutionary biology also promotes humanism, both atheism and humanism. And to complicate matters, I'll try to show how humanism promotes atheism in a sort of roundabout way. So what I'm really talking about today is a sort of complicated nexus of evolutionary biology, which can stand for all science, and the rejection of deities, and the humanistic philosophy which underpins this conference. So here's my thesis. Again, this is something that I would never say in a meeting of the general public, although this is going to be on YouTube, I guess, and so it's going to get out. But I really believe it, and I don't have any regrets about saying it. The fact of evolution is not only inherently atheistic, but it's inherently anti-theistic. That is, it leads you to oppose certain tenets of religion. Second of all, the implications of evolution are anti-theistic as well. That is, evolution has a list of things that go along with it, philosophical implications, that lead you to not only abandon belief in God, but lead you, in some cases, as in my case, to oppose those who have certain religious beliefs. And finally, accepting evolution will tend to promote the acceptance of evolution because the implications and the facts of evolution are atheistic and anti-theistic. And for the humanists, all of us, atheism will also promote the rise of humanism and vice versa, because I'll try to show you that humanism itself turns people into atheists. Karl Marx was the first to realize that. A bit about my personal journey, how I became from a straight mundane evolutionary biologist into an opponent of religion and a critic of religion. First of all, you start off writing a book about the evidence for evolution that says nothing about religion in it. There's one tepid sentence in the whole book. It just lays out the evidence for evolution. And then you think, okay, I'm going to convince everybody that evolution is true. Well, it didn't work. 43% of Americans are young earth creationists. And you sort of realize, yeah, it didn't work very well. And the reason is because I can't convince those religious people, no matter what the evidence is, to accept evolution. So you start reading a little bit about religion, and eventually you get sucked into this black hole of that they call theology. And when you do that, and I spent 2 years reading theology, you realize that theology is sort of like science. It's a pseudoscience, and that it makes assertions about the way the cosmos is, but has a different way from science of adjudicating those assertions. So we have these two. That's why science and religion are always opposed to each other. You don't see books on, you know, the conflict between science and baseball or science and business, because there's no conflict. But there is a conflict between science and religion because they're, as I'll try to show you, they're competing entities. So you read some theology and you find yourself thrown into this world which is sort of scientific but not really scientific. And you realize that as a scientist, you can have something to say about this. So that leads to this book. Both of these are on sale at fine bookstores everywhere, as Hitchens used to say, as well as outside the venue where I'll be signing them. Led me to write this recent book, Faith versus Fact, on the incompatibility between science and religion. Endeavor that I swore when I was younger I would never do. I said when I retired, I'm not going to do philosophy, I'm not going to do theology or anything like that. I'm just going to quit science, and that was it. But I couldn't help myself. The laws of physics determined that I would write this book. I'm a determinist. I think Richard Dawkins went the same route. I mean, the point is there's this ineluctable connection between studying evolutionary biology and giving up belief in God. This is what Darwin did. He started off pretty much of a theist when he went out on the Beagle, and by the time he wrote his book in 1859, he was pretty much of an atheist. He wouldn't admit it publicly. He wouldn't even admit he was an agnostic, but he certainly wasn't a non-theist. Dawkins went the same way, started off as an evolutionary biologist and wrote books like The Blind Watchmaker, and eventually wound up with his magnum opus on religion, The God Delusion, of course, which is a bestseller. He especially pissed off the religious people because he subtitled The Blind Watchmaker, A Universe Without Design, and that's a phrase that is guaranteed to anger religious people. As you'll see, that's the underpinning of one of their faiths. So I want to begin by showing you why evolution and atheism are partners in crime. But to do that, I want to briefly go over what the tenets of evolution is. And this will only take a few minutes, because most of you know them already. There are five. First of all, evolution happens. Populations transform themselves genetically over time. Second of all, it's a gradual process. That is, evolution doesn't occur overnight, particularly substantial change like reptiles into mammals. It is not the changes of individuals, it is populations that become transformed genetically over time. Third of all, and this is my area of expertise, is a process of speciation, whereby not just the single lineage changes, as in points one and two, but that lineages themselves split into new species. And then those lineages split, and so what we get is this ramifying tree of life that's resulted in the 9 million odd species that are estimated to exist on the planet today. That's the tree of life now, and it's so complicated it can't be represented as a tree. This is by no means every species on Earth. But you can see, there's no laser pointer here, is there, by any chance? No? And I don't really need mine. You can see that everything in the upper part of the graph, except for those little tails on the lower right, are bacteria. Okay, there's us. Everything else is basically bacteria. So if you could conclude about, you know, what was made in the image of God, you'd have to conclude that God was an E. coli or something like that. So. Haldane made a similar statement about beetles, but there are many, many more bacteria than there are beetles on this planet. And many of them are unknown. The upper right purple part is new taxa, developed simply by sequencing DNA found in the soil. We haven't even seen the organisms. And we don't even know what they are. They're bacteria that cannot be cultured in the laboratory, but we know what their DNA is. The fourth point is, and it's a reverse of the third, because life is a branching tree, just like a regular tree, you can take any two growing twigs, existing species, and trace them back to where they have a common node, or neither a branch or a trunk. And this is the common ancestor of all existing species. So common ancestry is really the same thing as number three. Okay, so any pair of species that exists has a common ancestor. The more recent the common ancestor existed, the more closely related we are. That's the definition of close relatedness. Here's the family tree that Jared Diamond alluded to in his talk. This is just of primates, and you can see the branching bush of primate evolution, but that you can take any pair of species and connect them over time with their common ancestor. So, for example, this dot is at the common ancestor between humans and chimps about 6 to 7 million years ago. That's the common ancestor between humans and gorillas, or between chimps and gorillas, about 7 to 8 million years ago. The common ancestor between orangutans and the other great apes about 13 million years ago, and so on and so on and so on. Okay, this common ancestry is used as evidence for evolution, as I'll show you in a minute. And finally, Darwin's great idea. What propels evolution? Well, there are several forces, but the one that Darwin was made famous for is the idea of natural selection. That is, the differential sorting of genes based on their ability to replicate themselves is what's responsible for the evolutionary change that we see that looks adaptive, the marvelous fit of animals and plants to their environment. And that is a non-random process, but it's based on a random process, which is mutation. So these are the 5 points of the theory of evolution, and if you want to prove that evolution is true, or at least demonstrate it strongly, you have to demonstrate all of these 5 points, not just one. You can't just show that evolution has occurred, you have to show that it's gradual, you have to show that there's common ancestry, and most difficult at all, you have to show that natural selection is actually the force that operates to create adaptive change. But there's lots of evidence for that. Richard and I both wrote books about the evidence for evolution at the same time. This one outside, this one you can buy anywhere. They're both books that give a lot of evidence you should read. I won't go through the evidence, that's the subject of another talk, but it encompasses many areas of evolutionary biology. Fossil record, the existence of vestigial organs like our wisdom teeth, quirks of development, the fact that we develop a coat of hair at the age of 6 months in the embryo and then shed it, bad design. Anybody with prostate problems knows about that. Biogeography, the distribution of plants and animals on the surface of the globe, and we have now lots of examples of natural selection that we can actually see with our own eyes, a demand that creationists have made for years. So we have all of this, and you can see this evidence is drawn from many disparate areas of biology, all the way from molecular biology. For example, vestigial organs, we have dead genes in our genome, genes that don't do anything, they're silenced, but they are active in our relatives, like genes that enable us to smell. We're not very sniffy organisms, but we have smelling genes that are dead. If you look at your dog, they have the same genes, but they're active because dogs are olfactory and we're auditory and visual organisms. I'm getting ahead of myself. The point is that all 5 of those propositions that constitute the theory of evolution have been demonstrated amply, as you can see from reading those 2 books. It's regarded as a scientific truth in as much as science can show that anything is true. It's as true as the germ theory of disease, which is called a theory as well, or the theory of atoms, the atomic theory, which is also called a theory. So, as I said, when I wrote this book, I thought, okay, QED, this is the ultimate demonstration that evolution is true because there's lots of evidence for it, and there hadn't been such a book before this. So the American public is all, of course, going to abandon their anti-evolutionary views. Of course, that was a naive and foolish view because most of the American public remains creationist. Here's a Gallup poll that was taken in 2014. It's taken every couple of years, asking Americans, which of the following do you believe about how humans came to exist? And you get 4 choices, 3 basically. First of all, it's created by God in the last 10,000 years. This is young earth creationism, biblical creationism, or that evolution happened, but God guided it in various ways. And this is called theistic evolution. People that don't know are unsure. And then the naturalistic view that I teach to my students at Chicago, that we evolved from earlier species and that God was not involved in this process. Well, you can do the math and subtract. It's a very disheartening figure. Only 19% of Americans accept the view that we teach in the classroom about how organisms came to be and developed. That's 1 in 5. So if you walk the streets of America, you can be sure that 4 out of your 5 neighbors, or the people you see in general, not at the University of Chicago, but just in general, 4 out of the 5 people you see are basically think that either evolution didn't happen or God has something to do with it. These data, which are very disheartening to somebody who teaches this stuff, I wanted to show here that 73% of Americans think that God had some hand in the origin and evolution of life, either directly by poofing it into existence or nudging it along from time to time. That data has remained pretty constant over the past 30 years. The first poll was taken at 34 now. The first data was taken in 1982, and a poll was last taken in 2014. And this is the value of creationists, and you can see they hover over that period of 34 years between 40 and 45%. Theistic evolutionists, those who think God motivated evolution, they're about in 30%. And the naturalists, the people who actually accept the truth about evolution, those godless evolutionists, are down, you know, they're 19% now, but they've been historically low. There's one heartening thing about this theory, which is that the godless people have risen from 9% to 19%. And this may be a very real uptick that's happening now. I think it is. It's going along with the increasing secularization of America. So we have 31% of people being theistic evolution, 19% being naturalistic evolutionists. That means that of all the people that accept some form of evolution, 62%, or 31 over 31 plus 19, believe that God helped evolution along. So the majority of people that even accept evolution think that it could not have happened without God's intervention. So why does this, I mean, we live in an age, and this age that I just showed you, this period of time is the period of David Attenborough. It's the period of Stephen Jay Gould. It's the period of Carl Sagan, of Jared Diamond, of E.O. Wilson, of Richard Dawkins. All these people have promulgated evolution widely, and you don't have to go very far to encounter these people. Yet, the data have stayed static over that time, when we have all this wonderful science popularization and promulgation. Well, why is that? It's manifestly obvious, but as Jared said, it's not politically correct to say that it's because of the hegemony of religion in the United States. Because the only important enemy of religion, the only opposition that evolutionary biology really faces, is from religion. Without religion, there would be no reason to doubt evolution. Because after all, there's evidence for it. The only reason to doubt it is if your God tells you in your scripture that it didn't happen. And this is manifestly true. But again, if you go out in the public and say, well, it's religion that's keeping evolution away from our kids, people go after you because they consider that an indirect criticism of religion, which is a no-no in this society. But it's obvious. These are some of the more famous anti-evolution organizations. And you can see that a lot of them couch themselves as ministries. So it's clearly obvious where they come from. Even Intelligent Design, which says it's divorced from religion, but it's not really not. It's called creationism in a cheap tuxedo, is also religiously motivated. And you can find that easily by just Googling Intelligent Design or the Wedge document, which is their founding document. So the creationists themselves will, although they deny it, they use an evidence-based argument, but it's always explicitly based on religion. All those organizations are religion. And in fact, if you ask Americans themselves why they reject evolution, and you ask the rejectors, this is a poll that was taken by the Gallup organization 9 years ago, the most common reason is not because of the lack of evidence, it's because of what their God tells them. So the first three reasons people reject evolution, I believe in Jesus, I believe in Almighty God, and due to my religion, those have nothing to do with evidence. They're all based on religion. It's only when you get to reason number 4, 14% of the denialists, that there's not enough scientific evidence to prove otherwise. Okay, well, there is, but, you know, that's what those people say. And then the rest of the reasons are also religious. I'm a Christian. That's enough said. I'm a Christian. The Bible said it. I believe it. So of all the people that deny evolution, 83% of them that give reasons give religious reasons. So this is the problem that we're facing. We're not facing a problem of ignorance or lack of people telling you about evolution. We're facing a problem of religion putting blinders on the American public so they simply will not see evolution. This is not just true in America, it's true throughout the world. Here's a plot I made showing a correlation amongst 32 European countries between the degree of belief in God in a given country, which is assessed in the same way, and the acceptance of evolution, of human evolution in those countries. And here you can see that there's a negative relationship. The more the nations of a country, again, each one of these is a country, the more religious a country is, the more likely that people are to believe in God, the less likely they are to accept evolution. There's the regression line, for those of you who are statistical in that, and it's highly significant. It would be even more significant if we could plot the countries from the Middle East, because they'd all fall down here with huge belief in God. I'm over 95% in some Middle Eastern Muslim countries, and almost no acceptance of evolution, because the Quran tells you that God was that Allah created humans, and the Quran is to be taken literally. So the correlation is even more striking than I give you here. This is what economists call an inelastic demand curve for God, which means that you have to give up a lot of religion to accept a little bit of Darwin. In particular, you have to give up 40% of your belief in God among countries before you increase your acceptance of evolution by 10%. So this is the problem that's facing us. Where's the U.S. in this curve? I'm ashamed of my country to show you, but it's right there. We're the most religious first world country in the world, and we're also one of the lowest to accept evolution. Amongst all these countries, that's Turkey. More religious than we are, accepts evolution lower, but we're second worst in this curve. Okay. You can see the same thing if you look at the American states, and you might not be able to read all these, but I've lined them up in order of the most accepting states. In other words, the blue lines are the proportion of people that accept the answer yes to this question, evolution is the best explanation for life on Earth. Red, no evolution. Yellow, I'm not sure. I've lined up all the states in order from most evolution accepting to least. You might not be able to read that, but at the top we have Vermont, Connecticut, and Massachusetts. At the bottom we have Arkansas, Tennessee, Utah, and Mississippi. You can see where I'm going with this. And then I plotted against this and looked up the data on the religiosity of these states, because we have some data, not complete data, on how religious American states are. I was able to find the 10 least religious states in America and the 10 most religious, and I've put arrows there, blue ones for the godless states, red for the red states, and those are the least religious states in America. You can see they all fall into the top of the graph. Those are the most religious states in America. This is the kind of data that we scientists love, because there's no overlap between these arrows. All of the red arrows are disjunct from all the blue arrows. The more religious a state is, the less likely it is to accept evolution, and vice versa. We don't need statistics to show that this is a highly significant relationship. Sorry? Oh, yeah, I can't see really well from here, but... Well, let me... Anyway, you'd rather be from Vermont. Okay, so what is the lesson? Well, the lesson to a biologist is, well, you know, because religion clearly from this and from other sociological studies puts blinders on people that makes them unable to accept evolution. One of the ways to get people to accept evolution is to get rid of religion. I mean, that's simple. I could get shot in some countries for saying that. By get rid of religion, I don't mean go put every religious person up against a wall and shoot them. I mean get rid of the hold of the religious mindset in America, particularly those. I'm not so worried about Quakers or Unitarian Universalists, but even Catholicism and certainly a lot of Protestant Christianity are the kind of religions that keep people from accepting evolution. If you're a Catholic or an ex-Catholic and think that the church is down with evolution, you're wrong, and I'll try to tell you why later. Now, opposition to evolution is one of the least harms of religion. So I'm not saying let's get rid of religion so that all the kids will accept evolution. I mean, that's a nice side benefit of getting religion, but there are many, many more side benefits to that are much more important, including, you know, the abuse of children, the terrorization of children, the marginalization of women, opposition to gays. Bishop Spong listed all of these in his talk 2 days ago. And besides, getting rid of religion is a complicated process, and that's one of the things I want to emphasize in this talk. You can't just go out and tell people, as Dawkins and I and others have done. It's a useful tactic, but not completely efficacious. You can't just tell them, okay, the tenets of your faith are wrong, and here's why, and expect them to give up religion. Because there's a reason why people become religious. A lot of it is because, of course, religion provides the communality, the social benefits, help in terms of need. But there's another reason, and sociologists are starting to realize this. Karl Marx realized it over 150 years ago, and that is that religion is probably a byproduct of social dysfunction amongst countries. And sociologists have written books on this. We're seeing more and more papers on this. This is an early study, early as 2008, by Greg Paul, in which he took 17 first world nations and determined how well off they were using a 25 criteria scale called the Successful Society Scale. So he combined these 25 indices of social well-being into a scale which runs from 1, very dysfunctional, to 10, highly functional. Those criteria include things like suicide, incarceration, alcoholism, availability of universal medical care, child mortality, corruption, things like that. They combined into a single index. And then he went and looked at the religiosity of countries. So each of these is a first world country. And you can see there's a negative correlation between the proportion of people that believe in God in a country and how well off that country is. In particular, the countries in which that are most religious are the ones that are most dysfunctional. And the countries that are least religious are the ones that are most functional, at least in terms of the scale. This was not designed to prove a point. This is just, the scale was designed before the countries were assessed. Now you can ask yourself, well, you know, this is a correlation, not a causation. And if you just look at these two variables, maybe there's a couple of explanations. First of all, maybe countries that have high belief in God tend to make their societies bad for some reason. Well, that doesn't really wash with me so well, because I can't really think of a reason. It should be the other way around, because religious people claim to be solicitous and helpful to their fellow humans. Religious societies should be the best off, but they're not. They're the worst. The other explanation is that if your society is successful, and you feel taken care of, and you have medical care, and somebody to give you food when you're old, you don't need a God anymore, because God is the default option that you have when you don't have anything else to turn to. And increasingly, sociologists are showing that latter explanation is the correct one, that indicators of religiosity follow indicators of social well-being a year or two behind, which implies that social dysfunction is a cause of increasing religiosity. So you can't just say, let's get rid of religion so that kids will accept evolution. You have to say, well, in order to get rid of religion, you have to build, and this is where humanism comes in, you have to build a society where people don't need religion, where they don't need to turn to a God because they have their fellow humans and their government taking care of them. This, of course, was, okay, that's the U.S., by the way, and you can see we're the lowest here. This graph is significant even without the U.S. on it. There's a negative trend. If you put sub-Saharan Africa in the Middle East here, for which we have statistics on belief in God, or we know something about their well-being, they'd all be down here. So again, the graph would be even more highly significant. And I'm embarrassed again. This is why the U.S. is the first world country that has the least acceptance of evolution, because we are the first world country that is the most religious. Same thing with happiness. The UN every couple of years plots a happiness index. They go around to different countries and ask people how good they feel about themselves. It's very well correlated with social dysfunction, because countries that are socially dysfunctional tend to have unhappy people. But here's the data. Just 52 countries plotted out of the 156 surveyed by the UN about how happy they are. Higher happiness scores here. And then they assessed people for how religious they are. Actually, I did that, or one of my colleagues did that. You can see there's a strong negative correlation. So contrary to common wisdom, the most religious countries in the world are not the happiest countries. They're the most unhappy countries in the world. Well, of course, you can understand why that is, because religiosity is a byproduct of social dysfunction. If you live in a dysfunctional society, you're unhappy, and you tend to turn to God, because that's all you have to turn to. The happiest countries in the world are Denmark, Norway, and Switzerland, by the way. The unhappiest countries are Egypt, Central African Republic, Benin, and Togo. Okay, most religious countries. This is, of course, Karl Marx realized this in his famous quote, "Religion is the opium of the people." It's better to see it in context here, where he shows that it's the opium of the people because it distracts them from the very real problems that they have about dysfunctional societies. So this famous quote is followed by, "To call on people to give up their illusions about their condition," i.e. that we believe in a God that's going to help us out, "is to call on them to give up a condition that requires illusions," that is to give up the oppressions and miseries that they suffer in their societies. That is the way to get them to get rid of this opiate, which is God. Okay, I want to get back to the opposition between science and religion with a statistic to show how clear this opposition is. If science found a fact that contradicted the tenets of your faith, what would you do? And Americans, this was a Time magazine Roper poll, Americans were given three choices. You have a scientific fact like evolution, it goes against one of your faith tenets, like Genesis 1, chapters 1 and 2. Chapters 1 and 2, sorry. Would you give up the tenet of your faith because it's in opposition to science, or would you reject the scientific fact and keep the tenet of your faith so you can keep your religious beliefs? What percentage of Americans do you think would reject a scientific fact because it contradicted the tenets of their faith? Okay, louder? 90, okay, I can see I'm talking in front of a bunch of atheists and humanists here. If I talked in front of a regular crowd, it would be like 50% or 30% or, you know, I heard 90. It's actually not 90, because at least some people in this society are reasonable. It's 64% of Americans, but that's still a worrying figure. This shows, for example, why people reject things like global warming, because it goes against not only their religious faith in some faiths, but also their faith that they have that everything's going to be fine, because opposition, there's other kinds of faith besides religious faith. Religion is only the most widespread form of a faith-based ideology, and science is the most refined form of a reason-based ideology. But the real clash is, as my book title says, between faith and fact, and you can subsume that into religion versus science. So this is not a very good statistic. In fact, 64% of Americans are not biblical fundamentalists. It's more like 40% or 30%. So, you know, two-thirds of Americans, despite the fact that some of those are liberals, will reject a scientific fact if it goes against their faith. And a lot of these are Catholics, as I'll show you in a minute. Okay, so let's talk about, you know, why evolution in particular is opposed to religion. First, I want to emphasize, you know, start a happy note, the benefits of accepting evolution. What turns people like me and many of you on when we study evolution? First of all, it's the true story of our origins rather than a mythical story written in a book. And it's always satisfying and in many cases salutary to know what the truth is as opposed to fiction. Second of all, and this is what turns most evolutionary biologists on, at least when they're having their spiritual moments, is the complexity in design that can come from a simple materialistic process of natural selection that actually started with inorganic molecules about 4 billion years ago. So when you see a squirrel and a fern, or a daisy, or a bluebird, and you think about the marvels of those organisms, and if you look inside them, if you remember your metabolic pathway chart from Biology 101, the gazillion different enzymes and things that have to be present in place to cause these organisms to live, and to realize that that all came from dirt and inorganic matter via the process of natural selection, well, that's just almost unbelievable. And of course, Richard Dawkins has written about this in very lyrical fashion. It's a very satisfying, wondrous thing to apprehend. There's new scientific questions and phenomena that would not be available to us if we didn't accept evolution. For example, take the question, if you look at birds and you see that the male, that one sex is brightly colored and displays for the other sex, almost invariably it's the males that are the colored ones, and with the peacock and the cardinals, and the females are drab, and they do the choosing amongst the colorful males. Well, why is that? If you're religious and say, well, God did it, then you have to explain, well, why did God decide to make peacocks with big tails? And theologians will say, well, God's a mystery, we don't know. But we have an answer in evolutionary biology. It's sexual selection. It's based on the different size and investment in gametes and offspring size of males versus females. So, you know, religion is a science stopper. It stops you from asking questions that can indeed be answered. You get a fellow feeling for other creatures or penchant for conservation. When I go to the zoo and look at a chimp, you know, actually everybody has this feeling when they go to the zoo and they look at a chimp, they think, that's so much like us, you know? Okay, well, if you're a religious person, you say, well, why did God make this animal that has this reaction in us, you know? If you're an evolutionist, you say, well, this is our closest relative. Of course it looks like us, and of course it inspires some fellow feeling on the part of us. So you get this whole new view of the world that's not available to you if you're a theist, as our relatives. And finally, a penchant for conservation. They were here before us. What right do we have to destroy what evolved? Okay. Now, there are some religious people that say, what right do we have to destroy what God created? So they're sort of on our side as conservationists. But This is automatically a byproduct, I think, of studying evolutionary biology. Now, this is why evolution is anti-theistic and why people don't like it, and why evolution in particular, amongst all the sciences, is the one branch of science that's singled out for hatred and opprobrium by the American public. Well, it's because of this. These are the implications of evolution. First of all, we're the product of this materialistic, blind process of gene sorting, and we're not the special products of God's attention that were poofed into existence. We know this for sure. I'd bet my house on it. Second of all, the fact that the design-like features of organisms, including our big brain, comes from the same mindless materialistic process. And if you tell a religionist that they're the result of a mindless materialistic process, it really gets their hackles up. I met Dan McElroy, ex-head of the Texas Board of Education in Houston a couple weeks ago, and this is what he wanted to rail to me about. Are you meaning to tell me that you think you're just the product of a materialistic, random, blind, well, it's not random, a materialistic, blind process? And I said, yep, that's the way it is. That shut him up. But it's true. That process involves huge amounts of suffering, waste, death, and extinction. Natural selection is not a happy thing to contemplate. Why did God do it that way? It's mysterious. There's no qualitative difference between life and no life. We've realized now that there's no boundary between the living and the inanimate, and so we evolved gradually through a process of chemical and biological evolution from other species. And naturalism and not supernaturalism reign. Okay, there's no indication of supernaturalism and evolution. The scary implications of evolution: the mind is part of the body. We don't have a soul, we don't have free will. This is all what psychology and sociology tells us. We're animals, African apes. That really gets them ticked off. And the religious people will deny that they're apes, even though every zoologist will say that we are. And these are the two most scary parts of evolution for people: that morality is not given to us by God. It either evolved as part of our life in small hunter-gatherer bands, or it's a cultural phenomenon, a cultural overlay of that. And the most distressing thing of religion: there is no externally imposed meaning or purpose in our lives, okay? Because that has to come from God. Purpose, by definition, is a teleological thing that is handed down by some designer. And you can see more about the nasty implications of evolution for people's psyches in this recent book by Steve Stewart Williams. The subtitle, Darwin, God, and the Meaning of Life. The subtitle is How Evolutionary Theory Undermines Everything You Thought You Ever Knew. And it probably does, at least if you're religious. Okay, so the dichotomy between evolution and religion can be expressed by this pair of dueling quotes. The first by Steven Weinberg, the Nobel laureate physicist, who said in a famous quote, "The more the universe seems comprehensible, the more it also seems pointless." And by pointless, he means not that, you know, we can't give a point to our own lives through our own thoughts and rationality, but that there is no evidence for any teleological force that is involved in cosmology and particle physics, which is his area. In contrast to that, we have John Hott, the Catholic theologian from Georgetown, who says, you know, religion can put up with all kinds of science, but what they cannot tolerate from science is the conviction that the universe and the life are pointless. So here we have, you know, a scientist saying that it is pointless, and a religious person saying, we can't deal with that, you know. They can't handle pointless, if you want to quote Jack Nicholson on the idea. But you know, the facts are the facts. So I just want to very briefly say what I think is the incompatibility between science and religion. You saw some of the incompatibilities between the religious mindset and evolution, but I want to talk about the stuff that's in my book, and again, you can get it afterwards, and I'll be glad to sign it for you. Science and religion are competing entities insofar as they both make assertions about what is true in the cosmos. But they come into conflict in three different ways in so doing. First of all, in their methodology. Second of all, in the philosophy that underlies their investigations. And third of all, in the outcomes. Religion and science reach incompatible conclusions about the nature of the universe. Methodology, I can sum this up in my favorite quote, because it's my quote. In science, faith is a vice, and in religion, faith is a virtue. That's the real difference between science and religion. In science, you have ways of knowing you're wrong. I could give you a slide, and we could talk about this later if you want, showing you the kind of evidence that it would take to overturn the theory of evolution. We know exactly what we could find, we haven't found it, that would show that Darwin and the rest of us was wrong. In religion, there is nothing in general that will dispel people from their faith. Even religionists have said, if I had a camera in Jesus' tomb and he just rotted away rather than being resurrected, I would still believe what the Bible says. There is nothing that would convince me otherwise. That's the difference. They make a factual assertion about Jesus' divinity and resurrection, but then they are unwilling to follow it up with the kind of evidence you need to support that in a rational way. And so in science, we have all these ways that have been refined over the centuries to adjudicate truth, rationality, doubt, experimentation, replication, looking at nature, making hypotheses and testing them, and the byproducts of professional science, blind testing, replication, double-blind testing, peer review, and publication in journals. Religion has nothing like that. They have scripture, authority, dogma, and revelation. That is their method of ascertaining truth. So these two ways are at odds with each other. If you arrive at a truth, like Adam and Eve, for example, or Jesus' resurrection, because your book says so, because you had a revelation, you saw Jesus, you know, up in the sky above Fatima, you have no way of seeing whether that's true or not, because a gazillion other people don't believe you. And so this leads to an incompatibility of outcomes. The methods that religion uses to arrive at what it calls its truths are different from those that science does. And that means that the truths that they arrive at, and these are just the truths that Christians used to believe before science told them this wasn't the case, are wrong. The creation story, the Exodus from Egypt, the story of Adam and Eve, the Great Flood, prayer works, and the fact that the earth is very young. These are all truths that until about the 18th century were agreed upon by Christians, and they're all wrong. And yet a religious person will say these are certainly the case, at least many religious people. So not only is religion incompatible with science and what it finds, it's religions are incompatible with other religions as well. Religion is incompatible with itself, and we all know this, but it's a dirty little secret that believers like to keep to themselves. Here's a history of religion over the past 20,000 years in a sort of evolutionary tree way. These are the different religions existing on Earth today. In fact, there are many more. These are just major branches. Here we see Christianity, three branches of Islam. There's the Jews, poor Jews off by themselves, as they tend to be. These are Eastern religions, and then religions of the New World. And in fact, this is woefully incomplete. We have 41,000 denominations of Christianity alone. And that is estimated by a theological seminary, the Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary. Okay, why do we get these splits? It's because religion is incompatible with religion. Almost all of these schisms depend on a difference in a truth asserted by one branch versus another. How many gods are there? Hindus say lots, you know, monotheists one. Is there a heaven? Is there hell? Is there afterlife? Religions split on that. Jews don't believe in that kind of stuff by and large. Can women be priests? Was Jesus divine? Well, you know, the Muslims will kill you if you say that, and yet it's necessary to get into heaven if you're a Christian. Can you have a blood transfusion? Are gays behaving immorally? Each time this is debated, there's a schism in a religion, and you get a new religion arising. So the difference between the conservatives, for example, and the liberal Lutherans in this country is that one branch believes in evolution or accepts it, and the other one doesn't. That led to a schism in the church. How do you figure out who's right? Well, we know who's right. Science has the answer. But the Lutherans, those conservative Lutherans, they don't, you know, they know what they want to believe, and the facts be damned. Now, in contrast to this, I'll show you the family tree of science, which looks like that. We only have one brand of science, and it is never bifurcated, because science has... because science is done in the same way in every country in the world. Whether you be a Hindu scientist, a Muslim scientist, a Christian scientist, and I don't mean Christian scientist. Let me say an evangelical scientist or an atheist scientist, you all practice finding out the truth about nature exactly the same way. When I go to another country, and I was just in India talking to some of my friends who are Hindus and scientists, we speak the same language when it comes to science. So there's no schism. Science hasn't divided. Science is compatible with itself. Although we do have our own arguments, religion is incompatible both with science and with other religions. I'm going to skip the philosophical incompatibilities because you can read about it in my book. It's a little bit of an arcane digression. Just let me go to the result of this dichotomy between science and religion, that science can find out what's true, religion can't. Science can actually dispel religious claims, as it has with evolution and with the Exodus and things, and religion can't do anything to dispel scientific claims. So this is asymmetry in the epistemic power of these two groups. And religious people know this, and they hate it. They hate it, but they have to live with it, because you have to be down with science if you're going to be considered an open-minded liberal person. And yet, as science advances, religious beliefs are whittled away. They're whittled away by evolution, by cosmology, by animal behavior, by psychology and neurosciences, which tell us that we don't have any form of free will, that we don't have a soul, that morality is not given to us by God. And then archaeology, history, and biblical scholarship, which, as John Shelby Spong told us the other day, is increasingly showing us that the Bible is a man-made object and was written with a deliberate purpose, at least in the New Testament, of fulfilling the predictions of the Old Testament. And so as science advances, religion is sort of squeezed into a corner of belief. And they don't like that. Okay, nobody likes their cherished beliefs, the beliefs that they consider, you know, part of their persona to be disproven. So what do? Well, let me say that religion squeezes science squeezes religious people on one hand, but they're squeezed on the other hand by these popular authors called the New Atheists. These are the so-called Four Horsemen: Dennett, Dawkins, Hitchens, and Sam Harris. And if there's anything in common about New Atheism as opposed to old atheism, the atheism of Camus, Sartre, Nietzsche, or Mark Twain, it's that the New Atheism is explicitly science-oriented. All of these people are either scientists or science-friendly. And so their view is that religious tenets are hypotheses that can be tested, and they should be tested. And if you can't test them, then you don't give them any credence. So on the one hand, religious people are being squeezed by the findings of science. On the other hand, they're being squeezed by these popular books that attack religion, and they are very popular books. What's a poor religionist to do in this case? Because you're thrown into this cognitive dissonance. Most religionists, liberal ones, ones that want to be considered modern, want to be down with science, but they don't want to look backward about it, but they want to keep the comforts of their faith. And the comforts of faith are more, unless you're a Unitarian Universalist, are more than just going to church and singing hymns and looking at the stained glass. They rest on epistemic propositions about the real world. But I'm getting ahead of myself. The solution to this cognitive dissonance is what I call accommodationism, the widespread view that science and faith are compatible, harmonious, and mutually reinforcing. That is, people will bend themselves into knots to try to show that despite the palpable incompatibilities of the scientific method and the religious method, and the differential assertions they make about the truth, that they're really harmonious, they can even help each other. We should talk to religious people, and religious people should talk to us, because we can all, it's a kumbaya theory. My assertion is it doesn't work. But accommodationism is rife in the US. Here's Francis Collins, probably the most visible scientist in the US. He's the head of the National Institutes of Health. He's also an evangelical Christian. He founded an organization called Biologos with the explicit purpose of drawing evangelical Christians into believing in evolution by trying to convince them that evolution really was compatible with their biblical fundamentalism. It invited them to see the harmony between science and faith. And the Templeton Foundation, which I'll talk more about in a sec, has pumped millions of dollars into this enterprise. Unfortunately, that invitation has been rejected. Biologos has been a miserable failure, because in the outset, if your aim is to convert fundamentalists into religious people by showing them that their faith really isn't at odds with religion, well, they can read Genesis 1 and 2 as much as everybody else can. And they're in some ways more intellectually honest than the liberal religionists who take everything to be a metaphor. AAAS, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, the biggest scientific organization in the U.S., has a dialogue on science, ethics, and religion. Its explicit purpose is to bring science and religion into some kind of mutually fruitful dialogue. And again, it hasn't done anything, because the only kind of dialogue it fosters is harmonious dialogue. It will not countenance discussions where religious people and scientific people are at odds with each other. Again, funded by the John Templeton Foundation. Templeton is a very nefarious organization. In my view, founded by John Templeton, the mutual fund gazillionaire, who thought that the study of science would give evidence for God. This was his guiding philosophy. And when he died, he left $1.5 billion to this enterprise. And now Templeton gives away $75 million a year to the enterprise of showing that science and religion are compatible. If you ever see something like the World Science Festival, or a program in which science and religion are supposed to be made harmonious, undoubtedly Templeton money is behind it. Okay. Templeton wants to answer the big questions of human purpose and value. Big questions, as I've come to learn, are those questions that sound good but cannot be answered in any reasonable way, you know, or any consistent way. Even scientific organizations have fallen prey to this "I'm a nice guy" syndrome, saying that science and religion are compatible because the supernatural cannot be investigated by science. Okay, this is wrong. It can, as I'll show you in a minute. Oh, by the way, the National Academy of Science, which issued the statement of compatibility of science and religion, 93% of them are atheists. And if you, every single one of them I've ever talked to in private will say, "I abhor this statement. I don't believe it at a second. Religion is a bunch of bunk." But they won't say that in public, because that is not a good way to present yourself to the a religious American public. Jeannie Scott, who may have gotten some honor by the AHA, she certainly should have, because she's done great work in keeping, Maggie says yes. She's done great work in the National Center for Science Education. She's now retired and fostering the teaching of evolution. But she nevertheless has to maintain as a political tactic that science and religion are compatible, because you cannot put God into a test tube. You cannot test the claims of religion. That is the proposition. Well, you can, and they have been. Not all of them, but some of them. And one of them is this study published by the American Heart Journal in 2006. This was funded by Templeton. It's the only good thing that the Templeton Foundation ever did. They decided to test the proposition that prayer could help you heal from cardiac surgery and heart attacks. So they did a really good scientific experiment, blind testing. How much time do we have, Maggie? Okay. So they did a good experiment with blind testing. Some patients were prayed for and knew about it. Some patients were prayed for and didn't know about it. Some patients weren't prayed for and thought they were. All possible permutations. And what they found is that prayer had no effect whatsoever on the rate of healing. In fact, it had a slightly negative effect on one class of patients. So this is the way that you can test. I mean, it's just like you can test the religious proposition of a young earth or creationism. There are many religious claims that can be tested, and if you can't test them, for example, that Jesus existed, if there's no credible evidence for that, then you simply discard them. Strong claims require strong evidence. So how do you show that science and compatible and faith are compatible? Well, one of the ways is there are religious scientists and religious people who embrace scientists, Francis Collins, evangelical Christian, Ken Miller, observant Catholic. They're both scientists. They both are religious. Doesn't this show that religion and science are compatible? In my view, no, it doesn't. It shows compartmentalization of your brain rather than compatibility. It shows the ability of humans to hold two competing views in their head at the same time. This is what cognitive dissonance is about, and accept them. It's like saying that, you know, that chastity and masturbation or sexual intercourse are compatible, because there's a lot of monks and priests that engage in sexual activities despite their vows of chastity. Or if you want to be more invidious, to say that Catholicism and pedophilia are compatible, because there's a lot of priests who are pedophiles and don't think they're doing anything wrong in doing it. So this doesn't show anything about compatibility. There's Steve Gould's solution, which is the most popular solution, non-overlapping magisteria, which was adumbrated in this book published in 1999, Rocks of Ages. Gould, who is a diehard atheist, I believe wrote this so he would look like a nice guy. I don't think for a minute he believed what he said in this book, but because it doesn't stand up to even the merest scrutiny scientifically. And here's his solution, and the one that you hear of most often, like from Jeannie Scott and the scientific organizations. Science tries to document the factual character of the natural world and develop theories that coordinate and explain these facts. The purpose of science, the bailiwick of science, is to understand nature. Religion, on the other hand, doesn't have anything to do with what's real or what happened or what's natural. It's the realm of human purposes, meanings, and values. So what we have is non-overlapping areas where science deals with what's true about the cosmos. Religion deals with what should be, how you should live your life, etc. That sounds good, doesn't it? The problem is, it ain't the case. Because religion, over and over again, with some exceptions, but certainly the Abrahamic religions, believe in things that are real about the universe. Here's a list of the proportion of all Americans, not just religious Americans, that believe in stuff like Jesus was born of a virgin, that miracles exist, that there's heaven and hell, that there's certain there's a God, 54%. These are epistemic statements about what is, okay? They're not meanings, values, and morals. These are statements about reality, okay? And in fact, it is the theologians and not the scientists that have rejected Gould's solution by and large, because they will realize and they claim that a way of life, religion is more than just a way of life. It presupposes beliefs about the nature of reality. These are religious people and science-friendly people that are making these statements. Francis Collins again, religion often makes claims about the way things are, which is true. So they've rejected Gould's claim because they know that for all the comity, for all the harmony, for all the good works and good feelings you get on Sundays, at bottom, that has to rest on certain claims about how the universe is. And those are epistemic claims, and that puts religion in the arena with science. And in fact, Ian Hutchinson, a science-friendly and religion-friendly physicist at MIT, has said that whatever Gould said about religion, he's wrong, because the kind of religion that Gould claims exists, one that doesn't say anything about the nature of the universe, could never be Christianity, Judaism, or Islam. It couldn't be. Okay, and honest theologians, and that's somewhat of an oxymoron, recognize this, and they are the biggest opponents of Gould's theory. By and large, scientists don't have any problem with this. We don't want to get involved in the fight between science and religion. Okay, I just want to, okay, oh, and it's just on the other side, the claim that meanings, values, and morals come from religion. Well, there's a whole history of secular investigation of meaning, morals, and values. 1 minute, whoa, okay. I better wind up. I'm from Plato to Kant, Hume, Aristotle, John Rawls, etc. You sure that's 1 minute? Okay, well, I'm going to have to skip a lot. What I wanted to show is that there's a test of accommodation with Adam and Eve, that we know now from genetics that the human population size was never 2, even though that's maintained by the Roman Catholic Church. The minimum it has been in the last couple million years is 12,500. So this absolutely falsifies Adam and Eve, but the Christian Church and the Catholic Church in particular still maintains that Adam and Eve are the ancestors of all of us. This is flatly denied by many Americans, and the way that people try to accommodate that, to reconcile the conflict between genetics and Genesis, is to see them as metaphorical. And this is what John Shelby Spong did, and that's one problem I had with John Shelby Spong's talk. If you see the Bible as a metaphor, then where's the truth in it? I mean, if Adam and Eve are metaphors for, say, our evolved tendency to be xenophobic or brutal, then why isn't Jesus a metaphor too? I mean, he could be a metaphor for the increasing morality that Steve Pinker writes about, et cetera. There is no criterion in Scripture to distinguish what's a metaphor from what's true. And certainly Genesis 1 and 2 and Adam and Eve were taken as metaphors for, and this is what you also have to believe, that Jesus died for a metaphor, if Jesus himself was a metaphor. Okay. At the end, I just want to point out that there's a huge incompatibility between science and religion based on the number of scientists that are atheists, that 3-7% of the American public are atheists, but as you go higher and higher in the scientific hierarchy, you become more and more atheistic. 42% of Americans are agnostic or atheists. If you're an elite scientist doing research at a good university, 72% non-believers, and members of the National Academy of Science, 93%. Now, this could mean either that non-believers tend to gravitate towards science, or that science turns believers into non-believers. It doesn't, and both are probably true. I think it's the former, more or less. But this shows at least some fundamental incompatibility between science and religion. So, can there be a constructive dialogue between science and faith as the AAS wants? And my answer is no. What's the point? What's the goddamn point of having this dialogue? What we need is a destructive monologue, which is, in fact, is what has been going on. Now, it is useful to talk to religious people because they can teach us about the nature of belief, the tenets of religion, the origins of religion, but they can contribute nothing to the practice of science. I'm almost through here, Maggie. So we have no need of supernatural hypothesis. Science, on the other hand, can contribute to religion by disproving its claims. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. You know, science could have proved religious claims. We could have found that prayer worked. We could have found that the earth was 6,000 years old, but we haven't. So we have never found any substantiation for the divine over the history of science, and religious people know this, and this makes them antsy. So to end up with, I'd like to talk about how atheists and humanists should promote the understanding of acceptance of evolution. How do we behave if we want the rest of the world to share our values of humanism, atheism, and especially, for me in particular, accepting evolution? Remember, evolution, I'd rather see a world that's humanistic than a world that accepts evolution, because humanism is more important than accepting evolution. But let's try to have the whole bag. What do we do? The first thing that people tell us is you teach evolution and shut the hell up about atheism and humanism, because that just turns people off. This is what I call the Dawkins canard. That's what you hear it all the time, that Richard Dawkins, he's such a strident militant atheist. If he just shut up about God, then the whole world would buy into you know, evolution. Of course, you know that's not true. And you know it's not true because if you go to his website, Richard Dawkins Foundation, and see the section called Converts Corner, you see that there are thousands of letters showing the salubrious interaction between Richard's work on God and Richard's work on evolution. You see, for example, when he writes The God Delusion, that that he not only brings people away from religion, but he turns them on to evolution because he's taken away their blinkers. Similarly, when he writes about evolution, like in the Blind Watchmaker, he not only brings people to evolution, but when you're brought to evolution for the reasons I've mentioned before, your religious views are dispelled. So this doesn't work. And I've never heard one person tell me what these people actually maintain, which is, you know, if Richard Dawkins would just stop banging on about God, I would gladly accept evolutionary biology. That's just not the way the world works, okay? Second of all, you can criticize religion and teach evolution not at the same time. You can give talks about religion and give talks about evolution. This is my general tactic, not because I'm trying to hide anything, but because you don't want to confuse the audience about what you're trying to do. You can do both at the same time, and this is what Jared Diamond said. You have a special audience here. You can really tell them the truth without fear of being shot. And finally, and this is what I really believe, what we need to do to get the world to accept evolution is to promote social change. In other words, to promulgate humanism. Because in order to get rid of the religious blinkers that blind people to science and evolution in particular, you need to get rid of their need to be religious, which is in turn what blocks them from getting science. Promoting social change is the ultimate way, I think, that we need to get people to accept science and evolution, because that dispels the religious blinkers they have. If I could change two things about our planet that would lead to the acceptance of evolution, it would have universal medical care and reduce income inequality, which are humanist values. Okay. I just have one more minute. People have accused me, that some nefarious bloggers in the atheist sphere said, well, Coyne's just, you know, why go to all this trouble just to get people to accept evolution? Really, do you want to have universal medical care just so people can accept evolution? What a selfish thing for an evolutionary biologist to maintain. That's not my point. My point is, if you want evolution to be taught, that's one of your goals, and you want these other goals as well, a better world to live in, you want people not to accept the fictions of religion, the best way to do it is to promulgate humanist values. This brings us to the next to last slide. There's this double-sided arrow. Teaching of evolution promotes atheism in the way that I've said, because it undercuts the tenets of religion. If you're an atheist, then, as most of you have learned, you tend to be a humanist, and vice versa. If you're humanism, it teaches you to be an atheist. And the arrow goes the other way as well. If you're a humanist, then you become an atheist, and then if you're an atheist, you're more likely to accept evolution. Humanism leads to atheism in the first arrow, because as you're a humanist, you are going to get rid of the conditions that make people become religious. If you get rid of those conditions, then they become friendly to science. So there's this double-headed arrow, but I think, you know, the ultimate goal of all of us, which is humanism, is going to have these salubrious effects. And the fact is, and this is the last slide, we're winning. I mean, you may not, you know, you may not know this from watching the political climate in the U.S. today, but religion is on the wane almost everywhere, certainly in all Western countries. This is the latest poll that just came out a couple weeks ago from the United States, showing the rise in the number of nuns, those with no formal religion. Over only a period of 7 years, it's gone from 60 to 22%, whereas all Christian religions are on the downfall. Same thing in the U.K. In only only 3 years, unbelievers, that with no religion, have come to numerically dominate Christians. And this is an amazing rate of secularization. So we are winning the battle for secularization. It may not be here in our lifetime. I look at our battle as like the medieval builders of cathedrals looked at. We're not going to be around when we see the final product, but we're putting in the buttresses and the bricks in the meantime. And I want to finish with a quote from Robert G. Ingersoll, the great agnostic, about the relationship with science and religion, which was very prescient of him. He was a science-friendly guy. There is no harmony between religion and science. When science was a child, religion sought to strangle it in its cradle. Now that science has attained its youth, I would say maturity, and superstition is in its dotage, the trembling, palsied wreck says to the athlete, "Let us be friends, accommodationists." It reminds me of the bargain the cock wished to make with the horse. let's not agree to step on each other's feet. Thank you. Questions?
Well, more than a question, I just want to throw out something very briefly. I think you have laid out things very nicely. However, in everything we lay out, there are underlying assumptions. I start with the assumption that human beings are the source of meaning and value, and that we define everything. And we define science, we define religion, and by looking at the proper definition of religion, and I know that's not popular, I've dealt with these people for 40 years and I know they don't agree with me, but underneath religion there is a naturalistic mention, is about the meaning of life, and I think if we can pursue that issue, we can find a way to replace all supernatural religions with humanism. And that's what I want to try to work for.
In other words, what you're saying, and I agree with you, is that everybody should become like John. Oh, sorry. What you're saying, and I agree with you, is that every religion should become like John Shelby Spong. You know, because he's the kind of religious person I have no problem with whatsoever. Unfortunately, yeah, when you say what proper religion is, that's one of the tactics of the Gouldians. I know what proper religion is, and it's not Christianity. It's not Catholicism, it's not the Jehovah's Witnesses, and it's not militant Islam. Well, ask the believers. I mean, tell somebody in ISIS that they don't have a proper religion and see what their reaction is, you know? Or tell somebody in the Deep South who's a snake-handling Protestant, you don't have a proper religion. You know, it doesn't work. Because, you know, religion, if you look in the Oxford English Dictionary, is defined explicitly as belief in the supernatural beings. So even the God of all lexicons says that that's the case. But I agree with you, you know, if people would conceive of religion as the Unitarian Universalists do, or as the Quakers do, or as John Shelby Spong does, I wouldn't be giving this talk. Because everybody would be accepting evolution, people would be trying to build a better world, we wouldn't have all this nonsense in the political process about abortion and women's rights and gay rights being abrogated. So, yes?
I have one simple question for you. I suspect you left out one data point. That's the number of people, when confronted with a medical emergency, tell the ambulance driver to take them to the temple rather than to the hospital.
That's true.
Why didn't you have that data point up there?
Well, that's a good point. I mean, Christian Scientists, of course, think that that's what you have to do, that the recourse is prayer rather than medicine. And a lot of Christian Science are starting to realize that science has the solution to their problems and not the temple. So when it comes down to it, yeah, people, and they're given a choice where their life matters between religion and science, they almost invariably choose science. People ride in airplanes, they use cell phones and digital watches. But the unfortunate fact is, and this galls me to end, as a religious believer, you never get to learn whether or not your religious beliefs are true after you die. So you can still entertain a friendliness to science and yet think that you're going to go to heaven and hell afterwards, and there's no way to disprove that, although there's no evidence in favor of that. Unfortunately, there are all too many people that they don't even call an ambulance. If you read the last chapter of my book, a lot of that is about the enormous number of people in this country who kill their children or injure them because they pray rather than seek medical care. It's a lot more than we think. There's Jehovah's Witnesses and Christian Scientists, that is the tenet of their belief, and in every state in the U.S. except for two, you can get a religious exemption from vaccination. Okay, so these people, even though the evidence for the efficacy of vaccines is available to them, still rely on their faith at the danger of their children's welfare. So I think the problem is, you know, a little bit more extensive than you mentioned. But yeah, when the push comes to shove and you're bleeding out, you call the ambulance. You don't call your Christian Science practitioner, by and large.
Yeah. I'm Vivek Palawale, one of the neurosurgeons. Amazing talk, by the way.
Thank you.
A quick comment and a question. There are two kinds of scientists. Scientists by principle who apply this scientific method to every aspect of their life, outside of their profession as well as in their profession. Mm-hmm. Then there are scientists by profession who apply scientific method only in their profession, but not in the rest of their life. Francis Collins is one of them.
Yes.
And he, in power, being a pseudoscientist, can be dangerous, so we gotta call him what he is, pseudoscientist. And the reason that happens is because of their deep limbic system for emotional hope, solace, and comfort is so powerful that it's taken over the rational prefrontal cortex. So that's the reason why they are. They can't get over their fear. But we gotta call them what they are, pseudoscientists. But the question was, in the beginning of your talk, you did say that evolution is random mutations.
Well, it's a combination of random mutation and a non-random disposition of that mutation by the non-random process of natural selection.
Yeah, but later in the talk, when you're talking to somebody who said it's pointless, life is pointless, the evolution is pointless, you said it's not random. You meant to say it's random.
What I meant to say is that the process of natural selection is non-random. The fuel for that is the mutations that arise are random in a sense that's technical and I won't get into. But yeah, what I mean is that, you know, that evolution doesn't have any inherent teleological direction. I wasn't able to get to that, but there's no evidence that evolution tends to go in a direction of greater complexity or lesser complexity or anything like that. So that's one of the arguments against theistic evolution, that there's no evidence that God actually has intervened in the process. And by the way, about Francis Collins' limbic system, I haven't examined that, but I'll take your word for it as a doctor. So.
Thank you, great talk.
Thank you.
One of the great comforts of religion is that it offers a solution to the things that ail us. I think that...
A solution to what?
To the things that ail us.
Yes.
I mean, the kingdom of heaven, it seems like a really nice solution to, you know, all the worries we carry around with us. I'm wondering, you know, similarly to the way that we abandon the typewriter for the computer, is there something that evolution has to, like a message of hope that evolution has to offer that may help us as a society move beyond religion into... you know, a lot of what you've shown us today.
Two points to that. First of all, it's not evolution that has the solution, it's humanism.
Sorry. Okay.
I mean, that's the point. And yes, I mean, I think all of us have lives that are probably, I mean, of course we vary in how happy we are and meaningful, but I think if somebody found that humanism was not a solution to their own travails and woes, they wouldn't even be here in the audience, you know. Again, we cannot overcome what Freud calls our ultimate fear, that we're going to die and go extinct. That's just the way it is. But we have to face the truth, you know. And that's one of the advantages of science and humanism over religion, is that we value truth above falsity. And the truth sometimes can be painful. I mean, you know, religion is not always a good solution to the travails and woes of people. Did you see the movie 12 Years a Slave? So you can remember in that movie that the slaveholder comes out every Sunday and reads to the slaves from the Bible. Why is he doing that? To tell them that, yeah, they're having a rotten life now, but their next life is going to be really great. Now, what does that do? It convinces people, as it has in so many places, that don't do anything to help yourself because God's going to help you ultimately and your exercises are futile. So I'm not even sure that, well, religion can provide a temporary comfort on Sundays, that in the long run it doesn't convince many people that it's useless to struggle because in fact, you remember, if you went to the comedy panel, you saw Victoria Jackson was quoted by saying, well, we shouldn't have to help the poor people because, you know, it's just going to prolong their misery. Let them die and go to heaven where they're really going to be happy. And that's what Julia said. It was a true story about Victoria Jackson. She really meant it. So I'm not even sure I accept your first premise that religion, it can sometimes provide solace, but in general it's a way, as Marx realized, to keep people happy in their position. But the real solution to the problem is not evolution, it's humanism, I think.
This is going to be the last question.
Okay.
Oh,
okay, yeah, I should do what John Shelby Spong did and say if there's a... My apologies for that. That's a good practice. Huh?
Okay, this will be the last one.
Thank you. I just wanted to tell you that in Colorado, and I'm sure other states, not only are there exceptions for vaccinations, but the law in Colorado defines child abuse with an exception for religious belief. So parents can't be prosecuted when they ignore their children's medical condition.
That's true, and that's something I really am very concerned about. 43 out of the 50 American states have laws that exempt you from charges of child negligence and even killing your child by withholding medical care. if you do it for religious reasons. So if you don't take your kid to a doctor when it has meningitis and it dies, you will be fined or sent to jail if you're not religious. But if you say, I did this because my faith did it, then you're let off scot-free or given a slap on the wrist. And 43 out of our 50 states have laws like this. We need desperately to eliminate these religious exemptions because it's child abuse. Those children have no choice about how they're treated by your parents. They're treated, you know, and as I said about vaccination, well, it's much worse than that. And in the last chapter of my book, you can read some really horrific stories about how parents killed their kids by praying over them when they had an easily curable disease like diabetes. And then they got let off. I mean, what kind of lesson does this give the American public? It's okay to treat your kids like this, and religion is sacrosanct. It gets benefits that philosophy and other things don't get.
I think part of humanism is human responsibility. And I think evolution does not prove free will, nor does it disprove free will. I think humanists have to believe in human responsibility in free will, not because it's a scientific fact, but it's the way they want to live.
That was a statement, but I'll presume that you want a response to that, and it's that science has, in the sense that most people believe in free will, that is, in any moment, we could make, if I was going to decide whether to pick up this with my left or right hand, free willers will say, oh, I could have done it either way. And if we were going to go back at the moment where I was making that decision, I could have done it this way. Well, the science has now shown us that this is wrong. We're molecular creatures made up of physical molecules. We obey the laws of physics, and that means that what we do is completely determined by our genes and our environment. So we don't have free will in the sense that religious people say. We don't have free will in the sense that most people think of. I mean, I know that what's going to happen to me in the next couple of hours has already been determined. And you can show this with brain scans, that people's choices can be predicted before they're even conscious of having made them.
But
I mean, this
comports human responsibility.
But there is responsibility. Now, if you read my writings on this, I believe in responsibility for several reasons. If you do something bad, you need to be punished, not because you're a bad person, but because to keep you out of society, because you may have tendencies to do harm, to give other people an example, you know, deterrence from doing similar bad things, and to cure you, to heal you. And so you have to be held responsible as an entity for the good, for the bad things you do, and also praised for the good things you do. But you don't do it because you think that they had a choice, which is retributive punishment. It's just what leads to the death penalty. We don't punish people because we think they could have chosen to behave good. Nobody can choose whether they commit a crime or not. I mean, I really do believe this, and this is what science is telling us. That gets rid of the idea not of responsibility, but a moral responsibility. The idea of moral responsibility means that we have a choice to behave good or ill. That underpins all of Abrahamic religion. It underpins the idea that you can choose to accept a savior. It underpins the invidious idea that being gay is a choice. None of those things are choices. Calvinism is the only religion that's actually compatible with what we know about determinism in science. So I think that we have to hold people responsible for their actions. We just don't hold them morally responsible. And I think that humanists need to believe this. I mean, the belief that we have free will is almost a religious belief, and then it's based on no data whatsoever. It's what we like to believe, even though the evidence goes against it. And we like to tell people that we need free will to keep society coherent, just like religious people say we need religion to keep society coherent. Well, I'm a determinist. I can't avoid the feeling that I make choices, because that's probably an involved feeling. But I can realize in a very important way how we change the judicial system of this country, get it closer to places like Norway, where the maximum sentence for a crime is 21 years, you're rehabilitated constantly, and you live in a nice dormitory with a treadmill and a cooking plate and stuff like that. That's the way to punish people. You don't do it on the basis that they make it, that they had a real choice about what they did. Everybody is impaired if they're a criminal. We just have to figure out how to deal with that in the way that's best for society. So, thank you.